Saints Ace. He's played so well, but they're going to pivot. They're going to go for the Graves first pick. Lilia and Nidalee down, so there's not that many AP junglers to counter array this Graves. So does Boogie have another AP jungle he wants to push bust out here? He's going for the Elise again. The Renekton is
not
available.
Do you like the Elise? No. Because, you know, we've seen the Elise Renekton. Yeah. Why do you not like it?
I mean, Renekton Elise is a good combo. The Renekton's out, so I would accept it if they went Renekton Elise. I would kind of accept it if they went Camille Elise as well, but Graves' natural counters are AP junglers just in general. They can farm fast in him. They win the 1v1s normally. Evelynn is up, so I'd much rather see something like that than an Elise. I just think Elise, the problem with Elise is you want a scaling jungler. You don't want an early game jungler that falls off. If Elise doesn't get ahead, she's so useless. So they're hovering lots of junglers here. They could be going for the Echo or the Set combo, maybe we've seen throughout the tournament. But
we'll have to find out.
Like,
I mean,
going for it. The Set flex is alive though.
PSG is already, you know, qualified. They were the ones that really popped off on that. It's not something that Kaedril loves.
Okay.
And of course, that Set is still a multi-flex. We can see it go to multiple lanes. Whether or not V3 will be willing to do that will remain to be seen, and she is going to lock in that Orianna. So you've got some reliability, some consistency from that champion.
I like this pickup for the side of LG. The Orianna is much better than just going for something like the Lucian, which they've shown in the past. The Leona for Mark, I think, is a standout pick for him. It's his most played champion. He has a huge, huge win rate on this champ, so Mark picking that champ up is really important for the side of LGD. I think they have three champs, three comfort champs, so V3 have thrown a curveball with the Elise. They have the Set flex for mid support. I wouldn't expect it to go into the top side so much unless they're really looking for those top dives early. So they can respond with AD carry here. They can respond with support. They can respond with a Volley Bear.
Blind Volley Bear, if that were to be top.
And I think Camille is much better. Pick.
One of the things that I'm even falling prey to, whenever we talk about hovers, it changes and the whole context is out there. So in this final game, in this elimination match, do or die. If you lose this game, you go home. That's it. End of story. And it's either a one-hour flight for the LJL representatives or a one-hour train ride for the LPL representatives. And that Volley Bear will be the first ban, removing that from their top lane.
Yeah, launching on the Volley Bear. He really likes that pick into Camille. They take that one away. I wouldn't be surprised to see a second ban in the top side. LGD have picked up the Leona. They could away ban away things like the Thresh. The Galio coming in as well. So that suggests to me that they think the Set is going bot because they're banning away Galio for the Orianna.
What do you think of it into the Orianna?
So the Galio into Orianna is generally fine. Orianna will get the push early as she does in most matchups because Galio is a mini champ, but I don't want to see Ace on that Predator Galio again. It had no impact both times he played it. So another top ban. I love the Mordekaiser ban as well. That shuts down the early gank setup when he's level 6. It does win against Camille on 2 to 3 items, so I'm expecting something like a Wukong from the side of launching here. We're really good with the Orianna, pairs it up pretty well. The Thresh ban does come in to stop the Leona from getting countered, because obviously you can flay the E when she goes in, so I'm expecting them to pick up possibly their support here. They are going to, they're hovering Caitlyn though.
I mean, if that Set is support, then they're leaving that counter pick for mid, right? On the assumption on V3 side. I do love the combination, as you mentioned, like Wukong, Leona, Orianna, Graves. There's a multitude of ways that you can get that shockwave down. And the amount of CC on initiation is fantastic. I think Yamato said it best earlier today. Pick a teamfight comp to hide and cover your awful teamfighting. I think that was pretty much it.
I think Malphite, Wukong, these two champions are so good for them right now. They've shown the Nautilus support, so Set is definitely going towards the mid. I'd like that they didn't pick Caitlyn, because then you have like a Caitlyn Set. Caitlyn Nautilus, not very good. So looking at an Ashe last pick. So if they take away Ashe here and they go for something like a Malphite or even a Jhin, I think if they just go full teamfight, they should have a really good draft.
Are you 100% that Nautilus is going support and set mid? Because Nautilus could go mid, and I'm just instigating.
True.
I'm just instigating.
Yeah, but then I suppose you'd have set bots. You could look at something like a Kai'Sa. That would definitely open up something. He's hovering the Jax, though. It is a good counter to Camille in the 1v1. It's not that useful in the teamfights unless it has 2-3 items, so that's the risk behind the Jax. Camille's a lot stronger in fights, but he's going to go for the Jax, so they've gone for this 1-4 comp. They've gone for the Jax over side, so he's definitely going to be pushing the side lanes. If he can get ahead against this Camille or this set, he can practically 2v1 them, so I would like to see an Ashe come out from the side of V3 here, just lock in some engage, make sure you have something to help with the dives in the backline. Or something like the Senna as well could work too. But LGD, pulling out the Jax into Camille. Respect. Are they going to go for a Kalista?
Okay, so if that Kalista does get locked in...
They're here to fight.
Archer. There's going to be a last second pick. So we're a little
bit
for the AD. So Xayah combined now with... It looks to be Nautilus. We're anticipating the set to go mid. Why are you so shocked about the Xayah?
Xayah is not a meta champ right now. I think it just doesn't provide as much as the Ashe, the Jhin, the Senna. It is really strong at 3 to 4 items, I will admit that, but it's only really strong paired with the Rakan, so Xayah without Xayah Rakan is not really super meta right now. If there's lots of AD bans, maybe it's good on a 4-5 for blue side, but Xayah without Rakan, especially in a game where you will get knocked out if you lose, I think it's a bit of a risk.
It's even bigger than that. When I take a look at the entirety of LJL Summer, Archer has a grand total of zero games on Zaya. So this must be something that has happened in between Summer Playoffs and now Worlds, something from scrims, or some sort of response, having that Featherstorm, the ability to jump away from some of the tools that will be jumping onto him from the LGD side. This is LPL versus LJL. Loser goes home and your Worlds run ends here. A story will be made one way or the other. And I think there's going to be significantly more pressure on LGD and their players. Never has an LPL team lost more than one game. Never has the region lost more than one game in the play-in stage. And we've already seen some of the Weibo fan comments and replies. So put yourself in the shoes of LGD playing in Shanghai on home soil at the risk of being eliminated.
Definitely. And I think I favor LGD's draft here. I think V3 have come to play. They've come to fight. They've got set Camilla Lees in the top side, so they're definitely going to fall off past two or three items. You've got Jax into Camille, so the Camille's going to fall behind. If Jax gets ahead, Camille will fall behind even more because they'll win the 1v1. You've got Orianna into Sett, so if the Sett falls behind, the Orianna's going to take over. Graves into Elise. If the Graves gets ahead, Elise will really suffer. So LGD have kind of gone for something that they didn't show at the start of the tournament. They were really going for the Lee Sin's, the Lucian's in the early games. Now they've gone for full scaling. They're essentially saying, okay, you get the lead, you end the game, see what you can do. So LGD, I think their team fights are really good. Their scaling's really good. They've actually got a really well-rounded draft with the Jax on the side lane. Yeah. Would have preferred something like a Malphite to get those team fights going, but the Jax works too. So V3 really need to start. They really need to ramp this game up.
They have to hit the ground running, land those first few punches to secure the Haymaker and the knockout punch. Literal knockout punch.
Literal.
Onto LGD. Definitely when you say my words in your voice, it sounds better than the other way around. But let's turn our attention to the gameplay. As you've already alluded to, with that Elise, with that set, Nautilus, you have to get that early advantage. Now, from an execution perspective, on the side of LGD, let's say even today, we're surprised at the number of errors and mistakes we've seen in execution, especially around some of those fights and those skirmishes.
Yep.
But the composition, the way this is going to play out, hopefully this will set them up for success and make their way into that best of five show match with Rainbow Seven. Rainbow Seven are already in the knockouts stage of play-ins, and they will face the winner of this game in a BO5.
Yeah, and Boogie pinging some assistance on the red buff there, so that basically tells you he's going to go red, blue, Gromp. That's basically the Elise clear. Always wants to get level 3 as fast as possible, so I'm expecting a level 2, level 3 dive on bot side. You've got the Nautilus, the Elise, really good dive combo. Not so much meta these days, because I think scaling jungler is just favorite more. Elise really needs to get this game ramping up. Boogie needs to get some kills, he needs to get some dives. And if he plays towards the bot side, then Paz is essentially just, he's on a sort of timer before this Jax gets two or three items, and Paz just can't win the 1v1. So LGD will have top of mid push. Perhaps they won't have the bot push because of the leash, so Boogie needs to get this stacked wave going. He needs to get the dive going.
The thing I do like about that bot lane dive, if Boogie goes that route, into a Jhin and a Leona, those are low mobility champions. And if you're able to combine the Blade Caller, the Dredge line, the Cocoon, there is so much hard CC from Elise, Zaya, Nautilus. Mm-hmm. It has to connect. And Kedril, you've already highlighted, it has to get V3 ahead.
Yeah.
That blue, gonna start the Grump in just a moment, and looking at the wave, it does look like it's slowly gonna be pushing towards LG. That grenade will do a little bit of work here, but gonna be risky. If they go for a level 3 tower dive, the rappel can help, but boy oh boy is that scary.
I don't know if LGD have the information as to where the Elise started. I mean, Peanut needs to backtrack. He needs to come back to bot side so he can cover them, because he can see top, there's nothing really to be done here, so I would love him to do Wolves, go towards bot crab, contest that, he has mid prio. But as we said, LGD, the solo lanes have the push, V3 have the bot push.
Yeah.
Boogie is backtracking himself as well, so he could catch Longxing off guard here, but I think going towards bot is the play.
All right, not going to be the moment, the call for the moment. I loved seeing Paz, by the way, use that hook shot to get out of range of the Counter-Strike, jump right back in, landed a precision protocol to the face of Longxing's Jax, both junglers near the chicken camp on V3's side of the jungle, and Peanut, with that shotgun, will be clearing out the wave. That's the smite secured on at least the big raptor. Boogie and Peanut just standing side by side. Gentleman's agreement. There's no need to fight now, so let's just back away. And Peanut We'll wait to see where Boogie goes. Doesn't step into the river.
Yeah, now LGD's wave is bouncing, so they don't have to really be afraid of Boogie. Unless he sprints to bot right now, he's going to go towards the bot crab because Peanut's going to go towards the top crab.
All right, there's the auto attack onto Mark. Dredge line will pull him backwards. Not going to find the route from the Xayah feathers. And at the end of the day, a fairly even trade, maybe a little bit LGD favored as it stands. And the wave continues to push in, but here comes Boogie. Like, is this a mandatory, like, you must dive? Do you think it's that serious?
That's the thing when you play on elites, you're on a timer. You need to get the lane snowballing, you need to get yourself snowballing. So the fact that LGD have avoided the elites level 3, level 4, they're not going to be too scared on the lanes anymore. And if Longxing can keep this top push up, he still has the TP. He did get a cheater recall off, so he has the Doran's Blade and the Corrupting Pot. So he's definitely favored in this lane phase. Boogie looking towards mid here.
He has the cleanse. Cocoon, not going to happen just yet. She a flash cleanse, by the way. So even if he were to be caught by the Cocoon, got the tools needed to get away. Phase Rush as well. Cocoon connects, but there's no real threat. Wave is pushing into him, so he's low on mana, and he'll want to back soon anyway as Paz gets jumped on and loses out that trade to Longxing.
Yeah, now Boogie did get Ace. He did help Ace get the mid push, so now Ace will get the first base. Xayah doesn't have TP. He'll be first back to the mid wave. So if Boogie can pair up with him and look for something over sides, then that'll be very, very good because he's going to have a lot of tempo in mid in the next 30 seconds to a minute. But Longxing jumps in and Boogie's around. He's
right
towards the lane.
That means Counter-Strike and Leap is on cooldown.
No TPs.
Very big minion wave to deal with. Boogie's going to step forward. Level 4 v level 4. Forces the flash. That's a successful gank. You need more, though. You need to repeat that. You need to get kills. You need to snowball. That is what Japanese representatives are looking for, and Paz will complete that TP. Take a look at the minimap, by the way. Paz is going to teleport in. Mark on his Leona, running all the way north.
He loves to do this. This is what we see in the LPL. Level 1 fights, level 2 fights, straight to the top side. Top wave is pushing into Paz, so Longxing needs to push it out. He does have the TP, so he can eventually come back. He has a ward in the river too, so Mark can look to pair up with Peanut now, because Kramer can just catch his wave, because V3 don't know where Mark is. Mark hasn't actually shown yet, so they can't pull the trigger on the bot dive. Kramer catches the wave for free, so they have a lot of topside control as well. So just good play here. Looks like they're going to start a dragon, because maybe they identify the top wave's pushing in. They know Peanut needs to go there to cover it, so maybe they can sneak a dragon.
Paz not access to Hextech Ultimatum yet. It looked like Peanut and Mark were making their way up top. Quickly touch on itemization here. Ace goes back with a Balmy Cinder. He's already had that Doran shield. Cull picked up for Archer. In my head, if you want to be accelerating, you're going to be running the game, like pushing forward. Is Cull the right call?
Well, Xayah as a champ is, it's not super active in a sense where you can just pop an Ash Arrow and start the engage, right? She's really reliant on the Nautilus, for example, or the Elise, the set diving in and her following up. And Xayah's not a champ that spikes on one item like a Bladed Rune King. She really needs three items. She needs Essence Revariety, she needs attack speed, she needs all these items to get some crit going, and then she can start making the plays, flashing forwards, getting the ults in.
Okay.
Boogie is going to get this bot grab. He has some bot push. Ace is level 6, so starting the strike wouldn't be the worst. There's no TPs on either side, so looks like he's considering it, but it looks like he started it, definitely.
Look at the vision, by the way. LGD, multiple wards defensively around the Dragon Pit and offensively around V3's red buff. It does feel like Peanut is making his way towards the pit, or at the very least stopping off there at the Raptor camp. Xayah and Ace both have access to the ultimates. Three members of V3 will help pick up this Mountain Drake, and LGD will be too late to arrive. It's reset. That's a small delay.
Okay,
I wondered how long it was going to go for, and there was no other support. So nevertheless, Mountain Drake goes the way of V3. With Infernal being next, that's 50% odds on Cloud, 50% odds on Ocean Soul, both of which I think could be very influential.
Yeah, and Paz just clearing out a pink on the entrance red there on their defensive side. And if you look at the pinks across the board, apart from the one that just got cleared, LGD had double pinks on the side on the red side of V3. They have really, really aggressive pinks in that area. They did have defensive pinks on their bot side, so they're definitely playing towards his top side. Peanut doesn't have the warrior just yet, so he can either look for something bot now or move his way up to the top side, look for an early Herald start. Longxing is stacking a wave. He will have the push, and Xayah is level 6 in the arena as well, so I think both sides have really good team fights towards level 6. You know, you've got Paz has the ult, Ace can dive in. But it all depends on who wants to go first, who wants to pull the trigger, who wants to go to Herald first, who wants to start the fight.
Well, it feels like V3 have to do it.
This looks like they might move to Herald, actually.
They've got LGD already 800 gold up. Yes, they have lost themselves the Mountain Dragon, but a 15 CS advantage in the top lane, a 20 CS advantage in the mid lane, I think expected in the Orianna versus Set matchup, especially during early on. And again, I'm going to remind all the viewers at home, Kadril was talking about this team comp from V3 and how LGD have the answers to what V3 can throw at them. So for V3, it is a matter of picking those fights, finding those opportunities, and accelerating the pace of the game. Get ahead early, or maybe you're not going to be able to take the game at all.
Yeah, and Peanut, about 30 seconds ago, he went to bot to make sure that he could get the push. He based, picked up the core field, and then Mark moved towards the Herald. So essentially, they both ran towards the Herald from different parts of the map. They meet up at the same time. Boogie and Reyna did sort of the same thing, just they're a little bit later. Paz has the top push. If there is going to be a fight here, it's going to be a 4v4, but Kramer's going to be there first because Archer was catching the wave, because Peanut was covering him. So this Herald's going to be forced for by looks of it. Boogie's positioning really aggressively.
It absolutely is the case. Archer's recalled. He's picked himself up. There's Berserker's Greaves, double long swords.
It resets.
As far as damage for now, Kramer, he's come back with the BF Sword and Pickaxe. That's a full reset on Shelly.
Archer should get here in time. Looks like they're playing through top, so Ace needs to join them. He needs to run, either look for a flank behind them or join them from the top side, because this is going to be a big scrap.
Five versus five. Here's the fight. Balmy Cinder, Doran's Shield for Ace. Comparison to Doran's Ring, as well as the Amp Tome. That's a lot of damage.
All good engage.
Ace is going to go in, manages to throw down the ultimate. The shield will buy so much time. Ooh. The Shockwave catches two from V3, but the chase is on. Nobody dies just yet. The curtains are called, and the tags are firing. Two and three. That's the interrupt, though. On to Kramer.
Has
managed to find his way into the back line, but he's found in between four people. The blue buff may just be enough to help, and it's Peanut that gets first blood, and the Rift Herald still stands.
Yeah, definitely. That was a pretty big fight. Lots of good mechanical plays there. The engage from Ace was good. The follow-up shockwave from Shia to deny the sort of the aggression that they had there. I mean, the Nautilus hook missed from Reyna. Boogie jumped in, but he had to flash out, so felt like they were overcommitting way too much into LGD, trying to get a pick onto Mark or trying to engage onto Kramer, but they blew their summoners, managed to get away. The curtain call came out, and then Longxing came from the top side because they basically initiated a 5v4 and it worked for them until he rejoined the fight. So LGD, they've picked up this Herald, definitely want to use it for the Jax, because if Longxing can get ahead on this Jax, it's going to be such a good spot. So watching this again, Ace looks for a flank. That's what he kind of needs to do, is set. It's the key, so he does get a pretty good engage, but this is where they overchase. The Shockwave comes out. Ace has to flash away. Boogie jumps in, and now they basically have to run away. He has to flash away. Double flash again. Archer uses the ult to peel back, and Paz tries to find something on the backside, but that's not all you're going to do as a Camille. You want to be in the engage. You can look for flanks, but if you're flanking 1v4, then you're just going to get taken out.
Yeah, do you see how long he was locked in place? Shield of Daybreak into the Zenith Blade. Even though he was close to dropping Kramer, maybe one more precision protocol could have been enough.
Yep.
It simply didn't happen. He got hard CC'd, and at 10 minutes, it's a 1,000 gold lead for LGD. The kill went the way of Peanut on the Graves. Summoner spells used all across the board here on both sides of the rift. So V3 do have this window that they can look to play around. But frankly, they need to be wary. They need to be cognizant of the fact that this team composition from LGD just will continue to scale up, will continue to buy time. And maybe he's going to be better at team fighting as well, which is something we're looking at during draft.
Yeah, watch Peanut on the map there. He just based now. He didn't actually base after Herald, so he just based now. Mark's hovering around. He's got the Warrior. They're going to wait to pair up, and this is what I really like about the LPL teams. They kind of pair up really well. Mark is going to go in, sort of, but Peanut's on the way. Kramer's ready to move, and it's going to be a contested 4v4 over Vision because the dragon's in 20 seconds. There is a double TP ready, so V3 responded really well. Make sure Mark doesn't get into River. Completely illegal. Stop him from getting the pinks. Make sure you keep the control, and just make sure you hit the spells on the face check because this dragon is really big.
10 seconds until that dragon spawns. The wave is being pushed out bottom there by Archer. Teleports available, by the way, for both Camille and Jax.
Yep.
So Longxing and Paz can join the fight, but it does look like Paz needs to defend the wave. Longxing has already left the lane, so he may be able to be in position without using that summoner spell, but nobody's rushing it just yet. Dragon's in the pit, and of course, look at this mid prior, so important. Because here comes the Hex Flash sideways. Wondering if Reyna was going to win on Xie.
Yeah, Xie has double summons there. I think Longxing just moved down to take the top grab there, so a little bit of extra gold for him. V3 need to look for some sort of engage. They're on a timer here, not only right now for the dragon, but for the game.
All right, there goes the Shield of Daybreak. That's a stun onto Mark. He's going to buy time with the stopwatch. Look at the damage from the Shockwave. Two quick kills for Peanut. Paz TP's in. The Showstopper comes down, and Shie finds his first of the game. Paz is locked inside the baby cage, and Kramer sends him to the fountain. Four kills, 3,700 gold, and that has to be enough of an advantage to safely secure the dragon.
Yeah, the Herald going to mid here. They won't get the entire tower, but they'll deny the second dragon from V3, and LGD just responded so well to V3 being over-aggressive. They used all their tempo to get the vision. They sat in a bush for around 30 seconds, and then Mark just walked up and said, "Hey guys, there's three people standing here. Let's collapse them." And they did. The Shockwave came out, hit two people. Peanut got his combo on two as well, so two people got instantly popped. The TPs came in, but it was just too late. Paz tried to pick up Mark in the end, but in the end he just went down himself, so 3-0-2 on this Graves. Peanut's definitely showing that this comfort pick is paying off, and Mark's kind of surprised here. He's like, why is there people here? So he pops the ult, pops the stopwatch. Peanut gets his full combo. Shia gets his full combo. Boogie gets popped. And it's just lost from there. The TP comes in. Ace does his best to try and solve the fight, but Paz tries to do it as well. Archer's kind of out the fight. He does have the ult. He does have the flash, but he just can't walk in there because he'll die as well.
Do you know, it just leaves such a disappointing taste in my mouth. When you look at the composition that V3 have put together, honestly, I wish you guys at home could have seen Cadrill's face when the Elise and the Zaya were locked in. It was screaming WTF.
Yeah,
disappointment, facepalming. And then you see there's no dives, there's nothing set up. And I acknowledge and I understand that I don't know what the V3's preferences are. And I don't fully understand where their player priorities are. But the composition had big question marks just from a meta perspective.
Yep.
They weren't able to execute. And now they're down 4,000 gold. And LGD are poised to take control of this middle game.
Yeah, and if you look across the entire planes, the meta's kind of evolved. People came in at the start thinking early game was to play. Now it's got towards the late game. LGD have adapted well. They've gone for more scaling, but V3 just didn't recognize it. They've gone for way too much early game. So now they need to look for mistakes and try to get some picks, and Shia is going to get ulted here.
I mean, he is indeed. He flashed over the wall. The shockwave's already been used, but look at how much damage he's putting out. Archer stays alive,
nice.
Not long enough. In a 1v3, Shia is able to pick up the kill. But look at Archer, he's sitting with, you know, thrift shopping, just picked up the Warhammer. In contrast, Kramer already sitting with the razors.
Yeah, and Shia gets arrested by the weak side police there. He does go 1-for-1 though, 6-0 in turret plates. And LGD are playing topside. That was a weak side Shia there on the Orianna. He did get shut down eventually, but LGD are pushing onto mid tower, they're pushing onto top tower, and Shia, the reaction from Archer was really good for the ult. And you can kind of see what Archer wants to do here. He has feathers on the ground, he thinks he's in range for the E-Flash, but it's kind of blind, so he misses it. Then he's kind of flashed forwards too far, and he does get taken down by Shia. So, not the end of the world going 1-for-1 on the weak side. They are going to get some chunk on the tower, but you lost your mid tower, and Longxing is getting so strong on this Jax.
Yeah, absolutely the case. Jax making his way towards Trinity Force. Peanuts Graves, 3-0-2, followed up by Shia on the Orianna. 2-1-3, Luden's Echo already completed. It's just a very good looking out for LGD, and reminder that if they're able to close this game out, they will play Rainbow Seven in a best of five. And the winner of that BO5 will then face the second seed from Group A.
Yep.
Now that is a terrifying prospect, and obviously LGD, a lot of people on Reddit and social media were saying that they anticipate and expect LGD to find a bit of a groove to step up. I think many people expected them to go 2-0 today. They didn't.
Yeah.
And they have lost a game to Rainbow Seven, so I'm definitely not going to count Rainbow Seven out in a best of five. But whoever you're going to have to face, it is a difficult prospect regardless.
Yeah, it's just scary on paper. If LGD do win this game, they do go to the best of fives, then it's more sort of their comfort zone, the best of fives. I think the best of ones is something that China hasn't really seen, so LGD will definitely a lot more confident in best of five. Now Longxing's gonna go to base. He's probably gonna pick up a Triforce. Dragon's in 130. They're gonna pick up the Herald as well. And you saw the trade about 30, 40 seconds ago onto Paz. Longxing was just, he was one-shotting him. Paz had the E away. He was half HP. Longxing took about 100 damage. So I'm very scared for V3 on this side lane. You don't really have a point and click CC other than the Nautilus.
Look
so
at
I
the
think
gold, Cadrill. Total golden game. She is 7,000. Peanut 6-7. Kramer 6.5. Then Archer at 5-8 and Ace. And you know, it's such a big drop-off when you look at the rest of the squad. It's going to make it very difficult to come back. So V3 need flawless execution. They need a very quick assassination of somebody on LGD's side.
And they're going for it now.
I think in any extended exchange or fight, that's a very good flash dredge line. Shea manages to survive for a few seconds longer. The shockwave catches at least onto Boogie, but the showstopper comes in. Shea still alive for a few seconds longer until finally goes down. Now Mark is running for his life. 300 HP. The dredge line catches him. Sidestep away from Reyna. 2-for-1 trade, but in a deficit, you will take those as V3.
This is exactly what you need to do as V3. Make the picks, but look at bot wave. It's bouncing into them. They need to fix bot wave. They need to defend top as well. Paz comes in, and Longxing is going to have to back off in the end unless he wants to go for the dive, but I think it's a bit too early for that, and the dragon spawning in 30 seconds. V3 need to base, so I'm not sure if they can get this dragon. Reyna needs to go to base now, and Mark's already running out, so he's going to get the wards first. So it's only the Cloud Soul, so it will only be the second dragon as well. So it's not the end of the world, but good pick from V3.
Yeah, very, very crucial, very important also for Archer to be able to pick up one of those kills. 2-1-1, he's got the Essence Reaver completed now. Team is still very far behind, but I love the flash dredge line to get past Mark.
Yeah, it just misses Mark. You can see it's pixels away from hitting the Leona, and this is what V3 need to do. The game is on a timer. They're losing on sides. They're losing in the mid prio, so Reyna here just says, okay, screw it, I'm going in. So he flashed on Shia. Shia had no flash from the earlier fight. and he is going to get taken down. But Peanut has kind of been quiet now. He did get a lot of kills in the early game, but he's been farming up. He took top tower, he's taken bot tower now, he's been counter jungling. Hasn't been in too much of the fight since the one around mid on the first Drake, but now he is really strong on this Graves.
Yeah, definitely the case. 300 gold bounty on his head, invading to steal away the Sentinel, and LGD will have full position on the Dragon. I think probably the right call here from V3, don't challenge this one, you're too far behind.
Cross map. Cross map is what you need to do when they make a play on side, on one side of the map. So if they go for the Dragon, you need to make a play top, whether it's denying creeps, getting a kill, getting tower plates, getting the tower itself, and Reyna identified that quick. Boogie's behind him, but Longxing does flash away.
Depth charge is a few seconds away, and despite the sidestep, Longxing gets caught out, locked in the Hextech ultimatum. Reyna holding onto the ulti a few seconds longer, the cocoon as well.
Beautiful.
That is chain CC'd for decades. There's not a minion wave to crash into the tower though, so it's a kill in exchange for a Dragon. And LGD will be able to defend the tower, so net positive still, I feel, in favor of LGD.
Yeah, but another weak side victim arrested there again. Longxing should have identified that his team went for the Dragon. He had no vision. He goes, steps up the wave, goes for a trade, and then Boogie and Reyna just identified it really well. Drop Dragon, cross map, Archer catches mid wave. They don't lose any towers, but at this stage of the game, V3 need gold. They don't need Dragons. They don't need Herald. They need gold. So getting kills is exactly what they need with this comp. Archer has two kills. He really needs to get Paz ahead as well, but Longxing dying does slow the game down a little bit. They are going to be about 10 minutes away from the Cloud Soul, so if LGD can keep it up, the Cloud Soul isn't the best on their comp, I must say, but it is just Cloud Soul. It gets you towards the Elder Drake, gets the games closing out faster, so this looks like it's going to be a 1-3-1 now.
I mean, look at that big jump between, you know, 10, 15 minutes from 1,000 lead to 5,000. It has dropped minorly, sitting around 4,000 right now. But as we said, V3, you know, they were on a timer, they were on a clock. They were not able to find the opportunities, or better yet, they were not able to create the opportunities, I think is the wording that I'll use.
Yeah.
You know, we talked a lot about Boogie's Elise, and Kadril set beautiful expectations on how he could gank with that Elise. Right now, he's two levels behind Peanut. 1-2-2 in the game, Peanut 3-0-2. So just simply not keeping up with his opportunity.
Yeah, and if you look across the items, Archer is building towards the Infinity Edge. He has the Essence Reaver already, so once he gets those two items and perhaps a Rapid Fire for the Orianna, he will be strong in those fights, no denying that. He doesn't have the Rakanta pair very well with him, so the engages won't be as clean, but if Reyna can keep these hooks up, keep these picks, I think V3 can slot to contest the game slightly, but they are still on a timer for this Jax, for this Orianna, and the team fights, if they chase too far, they can die.
When does the window of opportunity close, right? Are you talking three items for Jax, three items for four items? Like, just a rough idea. I'm not going to hold you to it.
Well, I think when Jax gets 2 to 3 items, Camille can never really win, unless she gets like 10 kills on an aura, of course. The Elise doesn't scale well at all. She can build towards the Liandry's, but even then, you're not really going to be that useful in fights. The Seth as well, you can see he's already down 50 CS. It's pretty hard to catch waves. He's just going to get poked out as well, so there's not really much scaling options on the side of V3. Unless Camille can pick up some kills and Archer can get some more items, I don't see them being able to contest the fights as much.
So if we get to the soul point on Dragon, pretty much tickets for V3. Yep. Like, it would require a monumental throw from LGD to, you know, let the composition of V3 back into the game.
Yeah, I mean, just based on the gold lead, 5,000 gold, it's a lot, but it's not the end of the world. But looking at the comps, it's not like V3 have any sort of tricks up their sleeve or any sort of power spikes that are going to change the game. It's really only Archer with the three items, or Paz if he can get the Death Dance, look to solo kill Kramer in the fights. But if they can keep up the picks, there's still room for hope.
Okay.
But they just need to keep finding them, because if they don't find one in the next couple minutes, I think they're just going to slowly, slowly bleed out.
2 minutes until the next Dragon. Infinity Edge was picked up by Kramer. And I do think we have to call out that Reyna's Nautilus has found multiple picks, multiple hooks. You said it just a moment ago, and I'm going to reiterate it for everyone at home. Let's keep our eyes on him. Boogie waiting. The cocoon went wide, and I think it was optimistic at best anyway. A couple of members of V3 making their way from the mid tower towards that banana bush and into the river. And for Vision, very defensive warding right now on the side of V3, and it looks like LGD going to try to challenge it. Longxing pushing in the wave bottom. We've got Kramer pushing in the wave mid, so they're just setting up. This is Dragon objective control by the numbers.
Yeah, I mean, the Dragon's spawning in 1 minute, so getting deep vision before that is crucial. Pushing out V3, making sure sideways crash, midwave crashes. So on the opposite side, V3, they're trying to make sure top waves are pushed out so they're not bleeding waves if there is like a Dragon stare down for about 30 seconds. So Ace kind of push out this wave, probably can look to base and rejoin his team. Archer is also basing, just picked up the IE. So everyone's coming out of base. They've basically got the items they need for a 22-minute fight. Just V3 need to get into their jungle on the bot side, sweep out these walls, try and get some sort of mid push, and then choose. Do we go through mid to fight this? Do we go through bot to fight this? Or do we just flip Nash?
Ooh, there's an interesting concept. Take a look at Ace, by the way. He's got the Dead Man's Plate, got the Sunfire Cape, so definitely going just frontline on that set. If he can buy enough time for Camille at least to maybe jump onto a
They're going to engage on this midwave, I think.
We'll have to see what happens. 26 seconds until that Dragon spawn. Xie steps forward. Command attack goes out. And Archer steps dangerously close. Luden's Echo as well as Banshee's Veil for Xie. And it is V3 that have a little bit of positioning in the river, but they've lost mid control.
Yeah, look at their solo laners. They're both on the side. Ace and Paz are looking for some sort of flank. They're looking at Xie. He lost the Banshees. He has the summoners as well. And Longshing's pushing in top, so the carries of LGD need to be really careful here. They're trying to spot them out. The Jin traps coming over the wall.
So
they're fighting over Vision.
So clever from Kramer, realizing the potential threat, having not seen the solo. That's a route onto Reyna. Dredgeline goes out. Mark is the target for now. Ace is looking to maybe use him as a showstopper delivery into the back.
That's
line.
A big ult.
LGD are now pushing forward. No Nautilus engaged. He was one of the playmakers we need to watch. Every ult available for LGD. V3 peel back to the dragon, yep. And they're setting up for
another. But look at the side waves. They're bleeding top waves as well. They need to fight.
All right, there's the rappel up. What goes up must come down. No engage just yet. Mark holding on to the solar flare. He's already committed the flash, and Longxing is now pushing Paz away. Ace has come to help, and take a look
Watch
at that command
ball.
Attack. Yep. It's so scary. Reyna will not be able to pop the Banshee's Veil from Xie, and Paz is taking so much damage from the rest of LGD. Ace forced to use the ultimate just to survive. Gets a shield for a few extra seconds. He's already down. The setup took too long. The lack of engage did not help, and the shockwave was fantastic. Xie goes down, but it sets up a triple kill for Longxing's Jax, the third dragon as well. And Boogie runs for his life. 7,000 gold in the lead for LGD.
And I think that's going to be all she wrote. They can get this dragon. They can move towards the Baron if they want as well. And Ace was really looking for that flank for about a minute. He still couldn't find it. Reyna thought he saw a window of opportunity. He popped Nautilus ult. They backed off. And if you don't have that ult for the fight, you're really going to struggle. So they are going to start off this Baron. Longxing does have the TP. Paz has the TP to respond. And Boogie's going to be in the area for a steal. Jin doesn't have the biggest amount of Nash damage, but Longxing should be able to take this. Has the blade, has the Triforce, so...
No flash for Boogie.
Boogie steal this.
Repel is available. He's got one more control ward. And
it's
we'll
getting
be able
a bit risky, the longer it takes.
The Tri-Bush. Now, with that Venomous Bite and Smite, there is a possibility. I'm going to hold my breath because I don't think it should happen. And if LGD could turn to focus him down, Baron goes low, easily secured. The rest of V3 arrive for a potential fight. Can they get so many stragglers? It is such a gigantic deficit, and Mark is not even going to go down. Zenith Blade connects onto Paz. Reyna dredge lines onto the wall, but that's another death to Paz. 0-4-2. V3 from Japan have lost all fighting spirit and power. It just feels like they have been outclassed this game. They were outdrafted this game, and LGD one dragon away from Seoul. With Baron empowered, they will look to secure the fourth seed in playing groups. There's another engage here from Ace. Let's see what damage they can do. Decent onto Mark. Another fantastic shot from
Xie,
but Archer, he does have the Eye Edge. He does have the Essence Reaver, and he was able to find a kill. Boogie goes down as well, and Archer sidesteps everything from the curtain call. So as it stands, LGD, they still need to get over the hurdle, but 10k gold lead. They have the tools they need, Mark.
Yeah, but Peanut and Kramer didn't actually base for that fight, so that's why V3 really wanted to start the fight even after the Baron got taken. So I think it all comes down to positioning here. Ace and Paz have been holding hands for the last minute trying to find a flank, but Paz runs away, Ace goes in, miscommunication. Now Ace kind of has to go in no matter what, so he does ult in eventually. Not that great, uses the W to try and survive, but as soon as he's dead, Paz tries to go onto Xie, does flash on him. They do make a call to go on him, but he gets an amazing three-man shockwave there and just about gets taken out, but... Yeah, this is basically a triple kill for the Jax. He's building towards the Death Dance. He's got Baron, almost a Cloud Soul as well, so... it's looking really rough for V3.
Yeah, so difficult. And then on the flip side, let's talk about LGD a little bit. You know, this is the fifth game that they have played. Obviously, the four regularly scheduled group stage games and now the tiebreaker. This is a slightly different look. It's patient, it's clean.
Yep.
Their team fights have been fairly controlled. Like, when I saw that Dragon setup, I had... PTSD thinking about LGD's previous dragon fights, where they butchered it. You know, where Kramer stepped far too forward in a four, you know, five versus four, and like throws the dragon.
Yeah.
We're not seeing that this game with the pressure so hard.
Just a few mechanical misplays overall. Just CA misstepping the mid wave, gets taken out, lost his Baron buff, so now these waves on top won't be buffed as much. So they're bleeding waves top rather than being able to buff them up in this 1-3-1. But it looks like if Xie can just push the waves and join his team in mid, and Longxing can just keep pushing the sides, they need to be ready to react, because if V3 look for a pick over sides, They need to be there first. So Mark and Peanut hovering around just to make sure he can hit the tower. And then Xie needs to be safe. That's kind of how it works, right? So the jungle support and AD will help Xie get the push top. And Longxin needs to be patient when they go to bot, so Longxin can get the tower. Then Xie needs to be safe. So it's sort of like a seesaw effect of getting the towers.
Well, there's the dive there onto Peanut. He's able to get over the wall. The dive follows through with a showstopper. Shockwave comes out, catches two. Peanut finally gets taken down, and that is a shutdown. Archer has the rapid fire cannon completed. He's trying to chase onto Mark, but here comes Longxin. That's a recall coming up from Paz. He may not be able to complete it. The Featherstorm gets a multi-man route from Archer, but he's got no flash. He's got no heal. He's got no chance. He's got no life. Longxin is on a rampage. 3-for-1. On a fight that V3 started, and LGD are pushing into the base.
They had to look for a pick. All the waves are pushing in. There's no more Baron buff for the side of LGD, but they've got huge waves pushing in bot, huge wave in mid, and Ace does just about to get away, but it's going to have to be a 2v3 defense. Can they defend the Nexus?
This is absolutely crazy. Ace versus Paz will not be able to stop it just yet. Kramer and Xie turn their attention to the inhibitor. Safe, controlled, and by the numbers.
Yep.
I was building up to what would be the final siege, and LGD back away. Don't make a mistake. Don't throw it out. And with 40 seconds to the soul, this is the right call. Imagine how much flame LGD are already getting for their performance from LPL fans. And imagine if they were to throw it at the Nexus Siege when a soul was 40 seconds away. So
just
kudos
like
to them.
That's, almost.
There we go, right? There we go.
Yeah, so Archer has picked up the Rapid Fire. He's got the three items, but V3, 12k down. They're going to lose this Cloud Soul as well. And Longxin is such a problem right now. No one can really match him over side. She is huge on items. Kramer has been sort of scaling quietly, using the curtain calls in most of the fights. And if V3 drop this, what can you cross map? There's nothing to do. Tier 1 top at 30 minutes doesn't really do much. So Longxin can go towards top side, push in Tier 3. And he has TP if they ever want to contest on the bot side of the map. So LGD have a clear win condition here to end the game. Let's see if V3 can mess it up.
Well, that's the plan, and whether or not LGD can execute. I mean, at the end of the day, it's such a gigantic mountain to overcome. Mark will throw out the solar flare. Boogie forced to flash away. Oof. The curtains are called. 1, 2, 3, and 4 will tag. But there's just not enough follow-up. And that is a very, very beefy set, by the way, nearly 3,000 HP. The Spectre's cowl to complement the two armor items.
Yeah, and most of the time when you have two inhibitors, every team is like, let's just go five-man top and end. That's not really the case. You want to have one or two people in mid to push in the waves, to sort of like herd the waves in, make sure they crash on the Nexus Towers, have one person hovering in between, which would be Peanut, and then have three members on the top tier three. So if you watch Longxin, he's going to run with the waves here. So it means V3 not only have to respond to the waves, they have to respond to him too.
Well, let's see how LGD finish off this final siege. You've got Peanut moving mid. Longxin bottom, he's going to usher in three super minions onto the final Nexus turret. This is such a difficult situation for V3. They're on the verge of being eliminated. So much damage onto Longxin, and he's blown up. Archer's been able to pick up the kill, but remember, all those supers are still hammering away on the Nexus turret. Featherstorm goes out, Bladecaller comes back. Nobody from LGD is rooted in place. That shockwave is gigantic! The stopwatch will buy some time there for multiple members of V3, and Ace is inside the back line. Mark still has 1,000 HP, and Peanut continues to push forward. Kramer untouched in the fight. Xie low on mana. V3 live to fight another day.
I think that's a mistake from Longxin there. He just went way too far. I mean, V3 were moving first. LGD couldn't respond, and he was kind of hitting the tower in four people's face, gets engaged on, does eventually die because the dodge fell off, and that's 950 gold for Archer. He just picked up his fourth item, so clearing these waves won't be a problem for V3. It's not like they have little wave clear. They don't have things like a Jhin. They have four items on this Xayah, so Archer is a threat right now.
Kadril, I like to play a game when we get to moments like this, where I say, what are the percentage odds of V3 winning the game?
I would say around 7 to 8%.
7 to 8%. I'm going to lowball you and say 7%, okay? We'll keep watching this, and if by some miracle V3 can start to win some skirmishes and defend longer, I'm going to ask you to bump that percentage for me.
If now, LG get Baron, I'm going to drop it to 1.
When I play this game in Europe, I tend to have a gut feeling that they could come back. I don't have that feeling right now. But let's see. Baron is being started
Paz
off
has
here
TP. They can clear
by
the waves.
LGD.
So they could try to contest it. The problem is the face check. How can you face check Xie on this Orianna?
Yep, you can't. Mark is just playing interference.
Oh!
Look at that damage from Xie. Archer and Boogie running for their lives. Baron is already secured. Boogie stuck inside the pit. That's Archer jumped on. He needs to survive, but he simply cannot. Two more kills to LGD. Didn't even need Baron. Odds dropped to 1%. And it will be Peanut running down Ace. That is four members of V3 down, with Baron empowered, with Cloud Soul, LGD pushed to the brink of elimination in the final tiebreaker game. Step up, play as clean as they can, eliminate V3, and LGD advance to playoffs.
Yeah, LGD backs against the wall. They definitely stepped up in this best of one, and credit to them, they've adapted throughout the tournament, and well played by the Peanut, I think.
Exactly, but take a look at the face. That is relief. That is not happiness. That is not joy. That is relief.
Yeah.
Because this was a disappointing performance for the fourth seed out of LPL. Even for their expectations and the challenging year that they have had, to get pushed this far is a surprise. I want to credit and compliment every other team in this group.
Agreed.
Because it has been one of the most exciting and entertaining and interesting group stages, definitely in recent memory.
Uh-huh.
But we will be saying to the LJL, we will be saying to V3, they're the first team eliminated from Worlds.
I had faith in them looking at their games. They looked pretty clean, but it just didn't come together for them at Worlds. The drafts, I wasn't a fan of most of the drafts. They were making lots of mistakes here and there mechanically, and yeah, like you said, LGD backs against the wall. They do take down V3. They need to mentally reset for the best of fives now, but wow, what a day.
Exactly. Rainbow Seven will be taking on LGD. Kedril, it has been an absolute pleasure
casting today.
Maybe we'll do it again tomorrow if you behave.
Oh, yeah.
After the break, we'll take a closer look at LGD's win as they secured a spot in the play-ins knockout stage.